Hi there and a warm welcome. I'm Sagarika Ghosh.
And I'm Rajdeep Sardesai, and we're delighted to be in conversation with each other at the Read Instead online festival brought to you by Juggernaut Books.
Be in conversation today about two, maybe you would say, incompatible personalities, Indira Gandhi and Narendra Modi. They're certainly the odd couple. Well, Rajdeep and I are a bit of the odd couple as well. So we are very pleased to talk to you about Indira Gandhi and Narendra Modi. Now, in 2017, I published a biography of Indira Gandhi, Indira, India's Most Powerful Prime Minister, and it is now slated for a screen adaptation being done by the renowned actor Vidya Balan.
In 2014 and 2019, I brought out two books on Narendra Modi and the elections that in a way changed India or defined India in 2014, and in 2019, how Modi won India. As we've disclosed, Sagarika and I are married, but our political thoughts can often vary. So let's get into this conversation where we are going to compare Modi and Indira. And I'm going to start, Sagarika, by asking you what I think is a central question, because your book said Indira Gandhi, India's most powerful prime minister. If you were to write this book in 2020, now that Mr. Modi has replicated Indira by winning two consecutive majorities, would you agree that maybe Modi is a more powerful prime minister than Indira Gandhi?
That's a very good question, Rajdeep, because, you know, in a way, I don't think Narendra Modi and Indira Gandhi would like to be compared to each other, because they both think of themselves as unique. But I've said in many of the conversations I've had that Narendra Modi really does play by the Indira Gandhi playbook. In many ways, you can call him Narendra Modi. And I've often said that, you know, Narendra Modi is Indira Gandhi's non-biological son, because he really has imitated so many of her traits. But having said that, I still maintain, Rajdeep, that she is still the most powerful prime minister. Because think about it, she split her own party twice. She declared the emergency. Now, I'm not saying these are positive things, but in the wielding and understanding of power and harnessing power to her own personality cult and spanning, you know, east, west, north, south, in a way that Mr. Narendra Modi still has not been able to do. Remember, Narendra Modi has behind him the power of the RSS. He has the power of the whole Hindu organization. She did not have the power of that organization. She, in fact, wielded power on her own. So, I would say that in the wielding of power, she is still India's most powerful prime minister.
It's a fair point. I like the name Narendra. Narendra. But let's be also honest. Mr. Modi did not have any of the support structures that Indira Gandhi had. Indira Gandhi was the daughter of Jawaharlal Nehru, a prime minister for 17 years. She got a lot of the power that she eventually used. She came from the Gandhi Nehru family. Mr. Modi is the outsider in that sense. You come from Vadnagar, you have no support structures, you come from a party which had never got a majority in the Lok Sabha. I mean, the best BJP performance until then was 182 seats when Mr. Vajpayee was the Prime Minister. So, in that sense, he had a major challenge, both personally and politically. The journey that he has made from Vadnagar to 7 Lok Kalyan Mark, can it be really compared with Indira's journey as a child of privilege? The fact that Narendra Modi led a party as which had never got a majority on its own. And he was, at the end of the day, a chief minister. He did the hard grind. He was a Pracharak, state secretary, general secretary, and then chief minister, then prime minister. He did the hard yards, which Indira Gandhi did. So, in a way, this has been the tougher journey.
You know, Rajiv, I'd like to contest that in certain ways. I agree. I think Mr. Modi's rise by his own bootstraps from Vadnagar to Prime Minister is remarkable. I'd like to contest that is because, remember, Indira Gandhi was a woman. She was a girl. And she was competing in a very patriarchal, tough political climate. And Jawaharlal Nehru, and this is what I found in the research in my book, you know, he really was, in his life, disappointed with his daughter. Because his daughter was not intellectual like him. She wasn't as well educated. She wasn't as accomplished. She used to fall ill all the time. You know, for Nehru, illness was almost like a crime. To fall ill was a terrible thing. So he didn't have great hopes of her. And she had to actually, in a way, she wasn't ruled by her father. She was, in a way, I would say, resisted by her father. Her father didn't really have any hopes for her. You know, he used to say, oh, Indu is very good at interior design. She's done some interior designing. I think he saw her playing a minor political role in the Congress somewhere. But to think that she would actually become prime minister is something that Nehru, I think, would never have dreamed of.
So, are you telling me that Nehru consciously did not, in a way, prepare his daughter to become one day his successor, his heir apparent?
You know, Rajdi, one of the interesting things I discovered in this book is the relationship between Indira and Nehru. You know, it's always said that he was the doting father, he would promote her, he would groom her, he would bring her politics, but it was actually the opposite. You know, she had some amount of distance from her father. You know, the person she really loved was her mother, Kamala Nehru, the frail beauty who came into the Nehru family and was attacked by her in-laws. And Indira was her mother's protector in that family. She stood like a sentinel to protect her mother. So her father, she was wary of. They had a relationship of emotional distance. They didn't have that kind of closeness. So she had to fight against, I would say, not comparable odds. But then, you know, again, I come back to it. Narendra Modi did have the power of the RSS and did have the power of the Hindu Sangha.
In 1966, had Lal Bahadur Shastri not passed.
The way history
would have changed. So it is unfair to, in a way, suggest that Nehru groomed his daughter to take over from him, because there was Shastri, who could have well been India's prime minister for an extended period,
yes,
and appeared to be succeeding for a while.
Who was very popular,
but
particularly after the 65.
And while Mr. Modi has had the backing of the Sangh Parivar or the so-called Hindu Sangathan, let's be very clear, the Congress in the 60s and the 70s was this dominant hegemonical party,
yes,
of a kind that the BJP never was. I mean, the Congress existed in every Indian village in the 60s, 70s, when the Kothari sees it as the umbrella party, which it was. So, Indira Gandhi had the Congress legacy or the Congress organization. She had the Congress system on her side. And I just wonder whether politics today in the 21st century is more competitive than the politics of the 1960s, 70s. It's an open question. Whether politics of that period, whether, you know, it was as fiercely competitive at every level. Look at, you know, the kind of media scrutiny that politicians have today. The fact that you have a new generation of politicians emerge from OBCs, from communities other than the Brahminical class that existed in the 60s and 70s. I think virtually demolished his opposition and almost invisibilized it. Indira Gandhi did it.
The same thing. I think what he also did is actually split her party. You know, she split her party twice and yoked it entirely to herself. And in a way, that's what Narendra Modi's done. But I maintain that she wielded political power in a much more ruthless way, because he's not had to do it. He's had the power of the media. That's what I'd like to ask you, in fact, Rajiv. I think if you look at the way Narendra Modi has evolved in his prime ministership, would you say that the communications revolution that he has put in place has changed the prime ministership of India forever? Because if there's one thing that Mr. Narendra Modi has done, he has communicated in a way that Indian prime ministers have never done before, not even Indira Gandhi.
You know, good point. I've, you know, heard Indira Gandhi's speeches on YouTube, for example. She's not a great orator.
No.
You know, she was never, particularly not in Hindi. You know, she was almost staccato at times. You know, she was not this fierce orator. And Modi is a demagogue. You know, they're both populist politicians. They're both nationalist populists in a way.
I think Indira Gandhi's, appeal, in a way, her message was herself. The media was the message. Because she,
so
was,
is
the, she was the Netzahibjan populist. She was the Garibi Hatam Messiah. She was the suffering widow. She was the suffering mother. She was, you know, every woman. She was suffering
my
daughter and wife. So I think, in a way, her the image that she had, the kind of personality she encapsulated, was also her message.
Modi as this sort of muscular, macho hero representing a certain brand of Hindutva nationalism, a can-do leader, a risk-taker. But when you look at the media and communication, let's be honest, it's perhaps far more important today than it was in the 60s, 70s. Look at the number of television channels that exist today, almost 400 plus private channels. Indira Gandhi had Doordarshan and All India Radio. Social media, the websites. Narendra Modi, in a sense, has used this multimedia engine to sort of, in a way, invisibilize the opposition. You know, it's a capture of power,
yes,
using the media. Now, Indira Gandhi controlled the media ruthlessly, particularly during the emergency.
Yes.
Gandhi was apparently sacked because of an editorial that he had written on Sanjay Gandhi. So, we often accuse today Mr. Modi of practicing a similar kind of politics of intimidating the media or directly dealing with media,
yes,
owners, bypassing mainstream media, not doing press conferences. It gives him an enormous source of power. He is what I call in the book a prime time prime minister. He knows He understands the media, understands technology, has a vast army of people working only on the media. In fact, my worry sometimes is that there's an over-obsession with the media narrative, with the result that sometimes the micromanagement and the planning gets lost in this high decibel, high voltage campaigns that you run, Tali Bajao, you know, Tali Bajao. So I'm just wondering whether Indira Gandhi was also, as Mr. Modi is being accused by his critics, perhaps justifiably at times, of being a bit of an event manager.
Well, you know, she had a tremendous sense of the political moment, which Mr. Modi also does. But you know, Mr. Modi also is a unilateral communicator. He, as you rightly say, he comes on TV, he comes on WhatsApp, he comes on the task, and he communicates his message, bombards his message. He's a creature of the technology. The technology drives him. Indira Gandhi was driven more by the political moment. You know, for example, her trip to Belgium in 1978, when she was out of power, and she was not prime minister. And she took that trip on elephant, you know, she had to, it was a village, Belchi was a village in Bihar where Harijans had been massacred. And Indira Gandhi realized that in order to lead that into the political spotlight, she had to stage an event and she had to sort of get the cameras on her. So she went to Belchi, and in order to reach Belchi, she had to go by car, by train, by jeep, walking, and then finally by elephant. So, you know, the
and all followed by the media.
And all followed by the media. And you know, there's a wonderful sequence where she gets onto the elephant and a photographer calls out to her saying, "Madam, are you scared of riding on an elephant?" And she says, "Bilkul nahi, ye pehli baar nahi hai jo main haathi mein chal rahi hu." And so you had this 60-year-old woman hanging on to an elephant bare back. You know, there was no howdah. She hung on with her bare arms, leaving her nails into the elephant. And the elephant went through a storming river, it went through mud, it went through uphill and downhill, and she hung on, and behind her was a companion, and all of this was captured by the media. So she was extremely good at political theatre. For example, when she was arrested in the Jeep scandal in 1978, she made sure the media covered every minute of it, because she made sure that the media was there, the journalists were there, when the police arrived at her doorstep, she marched out of the house in a stark white sari, she waved to the journalist, she was garlanded, and then while she was being taken to jail, journalists followed her, and then she stopped the car at one point and sat on the side of the road and held an impromptu press conference. She would have been a creature of, I can tell you, she would have been on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram.
So we'd have prime time competition.
She would be on prime
time. So Modi at 8 o'clock, Indira Gandhi at 9. Interesting, because you know, Mr. Modi has. You know, is someone who has this very acute sense of how he looks in front of the camera.
Yes.
You know, when he paid a tribute to Mr. Vajpayee, when Mr. Vajpayee died, you can see his hair is perfectly combed. You know, you can see an element, a little bit of a makeup that has been put in when he's addressing the nation. And he does it in a manner, you know, Modi ji bhavuk hue. He knows how to use the media, much as as Indira Gandhi knew. When to use the tear, when to use
that. What are the implications of that, Rajdi? Because, you know, the question I would ask you is, you see, what does it do to the party? Indira Gandhi more destroyed the Congress. You know, she made it entirely about herself. She made it about her family also. You know, the person who could succeed her would be not a party calling but her son. And if that son passed away tragically, it would be another son. So, in this personality culture, in this media management, and in this projecting of herself, she destroyed the party. Would you say that Narendra Modi, by harnessing so much of the political capital to himself, he is doing to his party what Indira Gandhi did
to her? Let me put it this way. The difference in that sense between Indira and Modi is Mr. Modi is also a creature of the Sankalp, the Pradhanubin staff. He's a product of that. And they had a very familiar, collegial way of operating. He's a, you know, in a way, has broken with that. A prachara who's so such a sharp individualist, who's obsessed with his sense of dress, who's got his narcissistic edge to whatever he does. It's extremely, it's distinct in a way.
Yes, but
the party president may not matter, but the organization does. And I think the organization sustains in a way the Modi persona or the BJP sort of rise. There's an election machine. Let's be fair, Amit Shah is there at the moment, and he plays an important role. I think Amit Shah has done a lot of the micromanagement of building a party machine, which perhaps Indira, in a sense, relied in her, you know, on Sanjay Gandhi for a while post-74. But that RSS machine, in a way, may ensure that the BJP does not go necessarily the Congress way. The organization may be able to endure beyond Mr. Modi, but there is a risk. When you put all your eggs in, you know, there is a risk. There is a modification of the BJP, like there was an Indianization of the
Congress. That destroyed the Congress.
It destroyed, but I think while it clearly could, in a sense, dilute the BJP's sort of appeal, because let's be honest, we are now seeing between the difference between state and general elections. The BJP loses about a third of its vote in several state elections, particularly when it's in power in a state, and where Mr. Modi is not the central figure. You see, this presidentialization of elections means that when Mr. Modi is not the central character, we've seen it in Jharkhand, we've seen it in Haryana, we've seen it in Maharashtra, in Delhi as well. The BJP is not able to sort of punch above its weight. They need Mr. Modi. And in a way, that also happened to Indira Gandhi or the Congress after Indira Gandhi. She was no longer there. And the party found it very difficult with a sort of scattered organization to have the same appeal. So I think there is a risk in this Modi model, as there was a risk in the Indira model, and the Congress has suffered hugely as a result of it. But I think the RSS will try, it won't be easy, will try to see that the organization is never decimated in a way that
Indira has decimated. Because what you had in the Vajpayee era, you had that very strong second rung of leaders. You know, you had the Jaitley, you had the Venkaiah Naidu, Sushma Swaraj, you had
Advani.
He reared these second generation leaders. So the question that we can ask about both Mr. Modi and Indira Gandhi didn't rear that second generation of leaders. You know, entire generation of Congress leaders were wiped out because of the ascendance of Sanjay. Now, in the BJP today, where is that second rung? You know, BJP was known for its vigorous, robust state-level leaders, the Raman Singh, the Shivraj Singh Chauhan, they're there, but you see, at the end of the day, are they risking a serious diminution of their political capital?
It's a tough one. You know, it's a tough one. I think what does happen with all political parties increasingly is they rely on individuals. This presidentialization of politics is becoming, or individualization of politics is a fact of life. These larger-than-life personalities who sort of dominate the political spectrum. In fact, the Modi model extends to regional parties as well. You know, each regional party, whether it's Mamata Banerjee, Nalu, or after Naveen Pattnaik.
So I think this also brings us to the larger question that both Indira Gandhi and Narendra Modi point towards, which is also what I've, you know, suggested in my book, is that, you know, in the 1930s, the enemy of democracy was supposed to be communism. In the 1940s, the enemy of democracy was supposed to be fascism. Today, the enemy of democracy is democracy. Because these leaders, these so-called democratically elected leaders, and think about becoming huge mandates, are themselves turning their back on democratic processes. So you see, whether it's the institutions, whether it's the free press, whether it's the judiciary, whether it's the civil service, whether it's the parliament, whether it's the office of governors, whether it's the office of the chief justice, whether it's the president, are they all getting yoked to this all-powerful political executive?
That's, I think, where the similarities are. Their conviction in themselves, this enormous sense of self-belief, although deeply insecure individuals, but controlling these control freaks who want to control the political executive, keep all power centered around the Prime Minister's office, means a diminution of the cabinet.
Yes.
Means parliament, I don't know whether Indira took parliament seriously, but certainly post-75, you sort of suspend all constitutional rights. And you had, so executive, legislature, certainly in the case of Mr. Modi, look at it, he doesn't address parliament on coronavirus, addresses the nation. Virtually sort of sidesteps parliament. Executive, many of his ministers at the end of the day are completely dependent on the Prime Minister's office for instructions. Look at the judiciary, where question marks are again being raised. Mm-hmm. And again, we're raised with Indira Gandhi, where she superseded judges. Then you have the media, the emergency in the case of Indira and Mr. Modi being accused of sort of sidesteps, not even dialoguing with the media through a press conference. So I think institutions are a huge question mark, and whether those institutions are so harnessed to the individual
I think they are similar. You see, so when you say presidential form of government, and we're getting at this personal, and remember the same thing is happening all over the world. All over the world, we have these elected autocrats who are arising, like a Trump, like a Putin, like a Viktor Orban, like a Recep Erdogan. So, is that the problem with these colorful, attractive, they sway people, they're the Dabangs, the Bahubalis, but while we give them our allegiance, yet we are perhaps losing our own democratic freedoms.
Look, at the end of the day, they're being voted by large majorities. You know, I think people are looking for that individual who will deliver. You know, while we have 543 constituencies, and as we are seeing with coronavirus, chief ministers coming into their own, at the end of the day, a national election almost becomes a referendum on leadership. And this notion of leadership, whether it's Indira Gandhi in 71 with her Garibi Hatao slogan, or it's Narendra Modi in 2014 with Acche Din, people want to identify with individuals. So in that sense, the candidates in a particular constituency don't matter.
Yes.
You know, people are saying, I will vote for Indira or I will vote for Narendra Modi.
Yes.
You know, the party also ceases to matter. So I think that in a sense is a major factor.
It's a major factor, but I think you know, on a lighter note, to sort of reverse back from the sort of slightly more depressing scenario of what these two leaders did to democracy, what they're doing to democracy and how they're damaging institutions. Indira Gandhi, in her personal life, was also tremendously multifaceted. She spoke fluent French. She used to ski. She was a great aficionado of the arts. She also, you know, was a great cook, and she had a specialty dish which she used to specialize in, which was Kulkuri Hindi. She was very good at making that. And she was also extremely fond of dogs and very fond of wildlife. So she was a very, when I was writing the book, I was wrestling with these two things of an attractive person, but quite a dreadful politician.
You know, Mr. Modi's not that kind of a family in that sense. He's a 24/7 politician. He's redefined, or I know, at the same time, he's someone who understands that he's got to sort of move to the next level by equipping himself with the trappings of a successful politician. So I think he's been able to, you know, there is a process of self-improvement in him. You know, I keep mentioning, I remember many years ago.
He's putting out yoga videos now.
That's right. You see, he is a feel-good guru. At one level, you know, the exam warriors, where he speaks to students, it's all designed to harness these events to the persona of Mr. Modi. So he's a 20, he does whatever he does with a political objective.
You know, as we sum up, I would say that every time you get the impression he's moving away from radical Hindutva, or he's moving away from extreme Hindutva, imagining himself as something else, he then doubles back into it and goes back into the rhetoric and, you know, Shamshan and Kabristan rhetoric. So he seems to be not completely distancing himself from that.
He won't, because I think he recognizes that to remain this powerful politician, he needs to harness Hindutva nationalism to this sense of being an inclusive governance guru. He's not going to abandon the Hindutva cause in a way that Vajpayee perhaps was more willing to. He's not a creature of the coalitional age. He's much more a creature of the Dabang age of politicians, you know, the strongman politician. And in Indira's case, the strongman.
She was the Bahubali Nasari.
He's the Dabang in his Modi Putra. Okay, that's been fascinating. We could go on endlessly talking about Narendra Modi and Indira Gandhi, their comparisons, their divergences. But remember, you can always read much more. Just read instead. That's what we are saying during this period of coronavirus curfew. And I'm told your book, and indeed my earlier book on democracy, Lemon on Cricket, as well as HarperCollins has a store where
books are
available, and the Juggernaut app is now for free during this period. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much for watching. Thanks, Rajdeep.